Hi, Ed.
Hi there, Jeffrey. How are you doing?
Good.
Oh, that's good to hear.
I have no idea what we're going to talk about today, but I thought I'd sit in.
Well, do we ever really have an idea of what we're talking about?
You mean even under the best of circumstances?
Even under the best of circumstances. But it never stops us. And every once in a while, something very useful and productive comes out of it, too.
Yeah, sometimes it does.
So, as Pink Floyd said, just keep talking.
Hi, Doug.
Here's Nature bright, Boy.
Bright sky and sun.
Yeah, I'm having trouble finding a spot. So I'm out here in the middle of somewhere. Everybody.
The wonders of technology. I just find it so amazing that we rely on it so much and it's so flaky. So you went indoors.
I'm in my next cabin here. This is wind-free.
Wind-free, yes.
Less boisterous. Yes. So.
Yeah, you don't have one of those fluffy things on your phone, huh?
No, I don't. Sorry.
Mitigate the wind when you're recording outside. Yeah, well.
So how are you, Jeffrey?
I'm good. Tuesday's afternoon's not a good time for me for these things, but occasionally I have an opening in my day and I can sit in. So.
Yeah, you guys are all messing me up because you changed your clocks. At least the Americans did. Did you guys do daylight savings time as well, Jeffrey?
Yeah, we're on the same as the Americans.
But you do the same time the Americans do. There's still some states that don't switch, though, aren't there? I remember Indiana and Arizona don't change their clocks.
Then there's always talk of other states changing as well.
Well, interestingly enough, the EU put out a... like a questionnaire, they but you know it was an open requisition of sentiment, so to speak, and you could express yourself how you wanted to feel. Because the question came up, but they're thinking about eliminating it. They're thinking about not changing the clocks anymore. They wanted to know how people felt about it, and 75% said don't do it. So
are they going to do it?
Well, they said that they were going to. The second question was, do you want to do it according to the moved time or the original time? And 60% of the people said, just leave it the way it originally was. and I thought, well, it was pretty clear to me that, you know, how things went on that and that they would implement it this year. But no, so we're changing it. But the Europeans, I think because of the German influence, always change the last weekend in March and always change the last weekend in October. So there's none of this early, later, whenever it is. And the Americans are always jumping the gun and dragging their feet, so to speak. So I guess they think they can get more out of the daylight savings time, but you really don't save daylight. You just screw up your metabolism for a while. So you get used to it.
Then after we're all on the same page with time, we'll have to go with inches to meters as well here. So,
that's pretty well everywhere else. I mean,
yeah, it is. My mother was adamant about not metricizing anything. She,
but I mean, I think the Americans are pretty well the only ones left who still.
They're the only ones left. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, the Brits still have miles when on their on the road signs.
Okay.
But that's also kind of a you know a hangover from whenever. But my mother learned to sew with eighths of inches and 16ths or whatnot, and she knew how to do them. My dad was a tool and die maker, and he didn't really care whether it was in millimeters or in inches. He could pretty well understand what it is that he needed to do. But I like it when I go to buy eggs, because you get 10 in a carton. I like to call it a metric dozen.
It's a metric dozen.
I don't think we have 10 in a dozen here. No.
Yeah. There'll always be some things that'll just kind of like hang on, you know. But if you buy a small carton of eggs, which I find interesting, if you buy a small carton of eggs, there's 6 in it.
Yeah, 6.
Yeah, because, well, it works out, because you can put 6 in much easier than you can put 5. You'd have to make them round or something, or pentagons.
Yeah, trapezoid of some sort.
Yeah, it's just, you know.
Well, I was just seeing something on Twitter where the Japanese are now printing sushi, 3D printing sushi.
Oh, really? Okay. I saw a video recently where a guy in, I think it's in Spain. He's 3D printing vegan steaks.
Yeah. So 3D printing eggs in tetragons could be coming, you know?
Well, it could be. Yeah. That's possible.
We've got TJ and John here. Great.
Did Barrett get on?
I'm going to double check. He emailed me.
The link wasn't working. Took 3 or 4 times to get on here.
Oh, so that's because we were all logging in and hogging bandwidth.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Because I got right on, which is unusual. I usually have to click a couple of times to get it there.
I think I'm here, but I don't know if anybody can hear me.
I can hear whoever just see you.
Hi, guys.
Hi. How you doing? Long time no hear.
Oh, my goodness. Let me try this.
Are we starting yet? Have we started?
No, you haven't missed anything.
We're recording.
Do we know what we're talking about? I think it's recording.
Jeffrey, once again, do we ever?
I'm making a cup of coffee. I'll be right back.
Yeah, make a cup of coffee, John. Get some drugs in you. Yeah.
Here, I've got one here you can have.
Yeah, where would we be without caffeine?
3D printers, but I don't know if you could teleport them.
Oh, hi, TJ. I can't see you, but I can hear
you. Yeah, I'm trying to work on my camera here.
What was this about humans and the gap between technology updates? There was some, Dave apologized for not coming today. Something came up and prevented him. Hopefully we can reschedule. Yeah, but he gave us a note. He said, humans in the gap between technology updates, which is sort of an enigmatic message. But I think it went somewhere into my cognitive unconscious or non-conscious. And I thought about it this morning. And then I'm having all this trouble trying to get on today. And and dealing with this technology and how miraculous it all is when it works, but when it doesn't work, we're all fucked. You know that. we're lost in our solipsistic little bubbles. Anyway, are we going to start soon, or is everyone here? I got a message from Barrett saying he was trying to get on. I don't know if he succeeded or not. Well, I don't see him.
I haven't seen him. If he keeps trying, I'm sure it'll succeed.
Okay. So anyway, I guess we can have an open frame. Whatever we want to do, we can, you know, just sort of.
I actually wanted to ask you a question, John.
Okay.
I didn't respond to the post that you made right before you said that you were going to deal with Heidegger on the weekend.
Oh, I did it.
Yeah.
It doesn't sound like a weekend project, though.
Since TJ's here, and he also found that so inspiring. I was kind of curious about your enigmatic Nazi comment.
Oh, okay. You want me to riff on that?
I would like you to riff on it. I purposely didn't say anything in the, because I knew you would be here, and I thought, well, maybe you could just say about your assessment there. I resonated to very positively. I found it an interesting way to describe.
Can you give me a pause? I'm looking up something. But please talk among yourselves, because I don't want to hold you up, but there's a quotation I want to draw upon because I think it's significant in what blocks me or what has been an impasse between me and Heidegger for many decades, actually. And I hung out with a lot of Heidegger in my 20s. They were all they'd all been educated in Berlin, most of them, and they were very interested in the Frankfurt School, and they came to New York, and some of them were affiliated with the New School, which, as you may know, a lot of the Frankfurt scholars ended up, like Hannah Arendt and people like that. They were all teaching at the New School of Social Research. So I was listening to a lot of these conversations, and I actually delved into quite a bit of Heidegger. And I'm going to, if I can find this quotation, I think what I'm missing from, for instance, I read that the question concerning technology. Uh-huh. Again, I read it before, but I wanted to prepare myself for whatever Dave wanted to do today. And at any rate, I can't find this goddamn quote. I'm sorry, I'm just going to press the pause button until I find this. So please.
Okay. All right. Go right ahead.
Whatever you have a response about Heidegger and your own experience with Heidegger and this particular piece that some of us may have read, I'm really open to hearing about it. And then maybe I'll find the quote that I'm looking for. Thank you. Okay.
Well, I could ask TJ, since he's here as well, other than the tortured sentences, what was making your head spin?
Presencing, bringing forth, and about 30 different other ways of describing what I took to be largely the same thing, but I know linguistically it wouldn't have been.
Okay. All right. I did make a little post on the conference. I found the translator more humane than most Heideggerian translators. Mm-hmm. And then he tried to explain in some way what he thought Heidegger was trying to say, because Heidegger speaks a German that no other German speaks. That's one of the, I think one of the problems that we have, but there is a certain amount of insight that he brings across, because German's one of those languages. I always maintained that if you learned like 200 root vocabulary and you knew how prefixes and suffixes functioned in German, you could actually mind boggle people for decades, because you get all of these subtle nuances. I found it interesting that, you know, when you read this, you have to carry along 647 connotations of variations on what that root meaning of coming forth or happening or coming to be or, coming to pass,
right,
means. But the fascinating thing that I find about it is that you can do the Germans don't bat an eye when you do. So you can like make up words and coin words, and they'll stop a little and they'll look at you because they know, okay, well, you're not native, so we don't say that, but they kind of know what you mean, and then we'll try to get you on the right path again.
And well, this Gebser did that, but it wasn't as confusing.
Well, Gebser did it in Gebser did it. He always explained what he was doing and why.
Right.
Right. And Heidegger never explained. I'm going to oversimplify here. And Heidegger
explains anything.
You know, you're always waiting for the explanation to come, but he's just going on about whatever it is.
I've heard one commentator say that you pretty much have to read about 10 or 12 Heidegger essays before any one of them makes sense, because they're a part of his project.
Yeah, I can see that. And obviously the translator had, because he kept making references to things in other works and in this own one where you know certain words we're using, and we're going to use it. Not what I loved when he said, we're going to use a different translation in essay X than I'm using here.
Right.
I found the quote, by the way.
Found the quote.
Okay. Jeffrey, were you going to say something?
Well, I was going to say something about this thing about Heidegger and Nazism, because and maybe I should wait and hear what you had to say first, Johnny.
Oh, okay.
But mine is because I actually referenced some of this material in a paper I wrote a few years ago, and as I was digging up the quote there. But why don't you go first, and then I'll go.
Okay, I'm quoting from a book I just started, The Duplicity of Philosophy's Shadow. It's by Elliot Wolfson. It's on Heidegger, Nazism, and the Jewish Other, subtitle. And I'm just quoting from this author. He's looking at the letters between Heidegger and his colleague, Karl Jaspers. We all know him. He was I think coined the term the Axial Age, I think comes from Jaspers.
Yes.
Jaspers had a Jewish wife. Heidegger dropped out of Jaspers' circle, even though Jaspers was a leading intellectual at the time. Of course, we all know that Heidegger allowed Nazism to infiltrate the higher education in Germany. I mean, he was responsible for that. He made that happen. That was his greatest legacy, probably. I'm quoting, Wolfson is a Kabbalist scholar. A brilliant guy. Anyway, he says, I am of the opinion that Heidegger was sincere when he spoke privately of his political loyalty to the Nazis as the greatest act of stupidity. Personal correspondence demonstrates that he was humiliated and dishonored. One of the moving articulations of Heidegger's disgrace is found in his letter to Jaspers from March 7th, 1950. And this is quoting Heidegger. Since 1933, I no longer came to your house, not because a Jewish woman lived there, but because I simply felt ashamed, unquote. In response to this letter, dated March 19th, 1950, to which I have briefly referred, Jaspers wrote, and he's quoting Jaspers, that you felt ashamed means a lot to me. With that, you enter into the community of all of us who have lived and live in a condition for which shame is also an appropriate word, unquote. And in response to Jaspers, in a letter written on April 8th, 1950, Heidegger goes into greater detail about his decision to accept and then to reject the rectorate. And at one point he professes, and quoting Heidegger, what I have reported can excuse nothing. It can only explain to what extent and how from year to year, as more viciousness came out, the sense of shame also grew over having here and there, directly and indirectly, contributed to it. Unquote. And to my ears, this is the author of this book speaking, these words convey heartfelt remorse and guilt. And this is what I miss from question concerning technology. I've tried reading him, and to me, it's just like obfuscation. And upon obfuscation, of course, I'm not a German speaker, so I'm greatly handicapped. But I do know a lot of people who admire him immensely, and who hate and love Heidegger. So I think it's entirely possible that we can do both at the same time. appalled by the man and his behavior, but recognized he had you know, a genius. This is not rare in human history, unfortunately, that people can be a mixture of the horrific and the sublime. Anyway, I'm just sharing that because I found this, Devor wanted it to be part of our list of things to look at, so it would be background for all of us, if it isn't background already, for all of us, as we're all trying to figure out this technology and what it's doing to us and what can we do with the technology. And so I think this is an open-ended question. So I hope that answered some of your question, Ed. Thank you.
Well, that was exceedingly helpful, John. And what's the name of the book again? Wolf's book?
The Duplicity of Philosophy's Shadow by Elliot Wolfson.
Yeah, I've read other things from Wolfson.
So you know his style. He's pretty
good. Yeah, I know his Kabbalistic background. I've only ever read Kabbalistic things from him.
But this is very readable. So far, it's extremely readable because he looks into the letters.
Actually, his Kabbalistic texts are very readable for Kabbalistic texts. So, you know, that's helpful. But I respect him very much as a thinker.
Yeah.
Because he's thought things through, you can tell. And you know, it's always bothered me. I'm not going to preempt what Jeffrey has to say. I'm really anxious to hear it. But it's always kind of bothered me that you can be a very brilliant individual, and you have a philosophy that says something about life and reality, and then you fall into this trap that Nazism, in that particular manifestation, it has other manifestations, but in that particular manifestation, and you kind of like go with it. But I always have felt, I think he recognized he fell for something. You know, he went down the wrong path. And once you do, it's really hard to get out of it, especially in the situation we're in. I've had that same kind of thinking about Heisenberg. Heisenberg decided to stay, you know, the only, and was working, you know, with them and collaborating and, you know, and promoting what they're doing. But there has to be so much of what you're doing where you realize I'm not just walking a tightrope, I'm kind of splitting myself between what I actually think now and what I realize is going on as well. And so that, you know, that the comment about the enigmatic Nazi was triggered that, because that's, yeah, you know, one of the things I've been kind of wrestling with him.
Because I did not, this was all quoted from his private letters to Jaspers. And this is not part of any public space that I knew about that Heidegger contributed to. He was totally silent on this. But it seems like in his private life, he did, you know, he was able to admit how ashamed he was, and rightly so. What he did was incredibly shameful, not letting Husserl, his teacher, into the library. That's about as low as you can get. The man who put Heidegger on the map, his mentor, he wouldn't even let into the library because Husserl was Jewish. I mean, and also he was having a love affair behind his wife's back with Hannah Arendt, who was the leading Jewish intellectual of her day, probably. And she got out because of Roosevelt. She was ending up in Paris, and I think Paris had just got occupied. And Roosevelt made a deal with the Nazis to get her out. And of course, I don't think the Nazis wanted to show trial since she was such a leading intellectual. But anyway, I think that's all backstory and backstage stuff. And Heidegger was extremely aware of all this. And I think that it's amazing some of his students, and he had some great students besides Hannah Arendt, who adored him, I think kind of foolishly, you know, but also Hans Jonas. He's another great thinker. And he was Jewish also, and he was a student of Heidegger's and a great admirer of Heidegger's. And he's done some of the best work on Gnosticism around. And he recognized the Gnostic voice in Heidegger. Anyway, I'm just sharing this not because I have any clarity on this, because I don't. But I think it's worth You know, I have other things to do besides worry about who Heidegger was or what his legacy is. And there are too many great thinkers out there who are also extremely, who could walk their talk, you know, and I wanna sort of, and when the saints come marching in, I wanna be in their number.
It is interesting how many esoteric thinkers, like René Guénon, for example, who was a brilliant esotericist, but he also marched right down that fascist path. And that I think it's really easy to do. And that's why I find it interesting. I know it's backstory and it's kind of gossipy on the one hand, but I think it also points out, you know, you can, and people admire Heidegger for the brilliance of his mind, but he's still a human being. And, you know, human beings just are full of foibles. You know, we just, and self-contradictions. And so I guess, you know, the bigger and the brighter the spotlight, the more that just kind of shows up and then you see that. But I'd really like to hear what Jeffrey has to say.
I think the discussion is interesting, but when I, so, you know, I mean, I've been interested long before Sloterdijk, actually, in work on embodied philosophies. And Heidegger, although, people point out that the body isn't very present in Heidegger's work, it nonetheless laid the groundwork for many of the later philosophers who did bring the body back into things. And in a sense, it's implicit in Heidegger's work. So, so Heidegger is kind of, he's an incontournable. You can't ignore him in the modern philosophical world, right? So the fact that he had this interest in Nazism is, I mean, I can understand the argument that about the person, right? Person and his remorse or whatever, but the issue is not only about person, it's about the concern that the philosophy itself that was expounded by Heidegger has some kind of internal pull towards Nazism in it that's distinct from the person. I mean, that's the worry, right? So it's not just Heidegger and his personal proclivities and his personal opinions, but the philosophy that he laid out and became so central to a whole bunch of, does it have this sort of internal pull towards that kind of thinking? And so when I got into this issue, I was worried about that question. So I dug around to see what if I could find. So I did find a book. It's by, I'll tell you the name. It's by somebody called Rockmore, T. Rockmore, 1992, on Heidegger's Nazism and Philosophy, which I didn't read, but it is the reference that I referred to, and I would like to find it, actually. I think it wasn't easy to get, if I remember correctly. So in the article that I wrote, Heidegger's seminal book, Being in Time, incorporates an understanding that being is fundamentally linked to its unfolding in time towards an open future that incorporates death. This being towards death incorporates fear of death as a necessary component of authentic being. On the other hand, Rockmore, 1992, suggests that Heidegger's idea of being as a precondition, being with a capital B, as a precondition to beings with a small b, that is, that being is both more universal and more important ultimately than being small b as they actually unfold in time, is rooted in a yearning for stability and certainty. I found this kind of interesting. This aligns with Heidegger's political conservatism, which predated his interest in Nazism. So there's a kind of sense that Heidegger's philosophy is grounded in something that is not completely separate from a particular kind of conservatism, you know, which relates to Nazism. So it's not quite the same discussion that, Johnny, that you're raising, but it's certainly one that I remain worried about, if you like. So
true. On the other hand, you have Nietzsche and the Ubermensch or whatever. You have Spengler, actually, he didn't get along with the Nazis very well. Hegel's historicism, you know, are these things feeding into the, are these things that the Nazis could kind of use and, or misuse, misread and run with, or is it the philosopher? I don't know if I would blame the philosophy that predated it necessarily.
I agree. It's just tricky.
Yes. Yes. Well, the elements being there.
Exactly. I think the point that Jeffrey made, well, at least it struck me in what you said, that there's this underlying yearning for certainty or inclination towards or desire for certainty. You know, because life and reality itself is, you know, relatively uncertain. You know, we really don't know what's going to happen next. And we don't know if and when we're going to drop dead or what, or if it's going to take a long time or whatever. And so in light of that notion, it is not surprising that a lot of philosophers, whether it's Guinon or whether it's Heidegger or Hegel or whatnot, would tend in a particular direction, because they are. And I think a lot of philosophy does strive towards finding certainty. There's a lot of absolute statements that get made about how things are and that, you know, the way it is. And it's very difficult to vary from that without providing an unstable foundation for something that you're actually trying to provide a stable foundation for. So
Deleuze, whose entire approach is to destabilize.
Yes.
So you know, that's in a way a counter argument. It'd be hard to see somebody take Deleuze's idea and turn them into Nazism.
No, yes, they would, but I think the admirable thing about Deleuze is he finds his certainty in this. This is the paradox. Exactly. This is why I think he deserves more credit than he usually gets. He's able to live the paradox.
Yeah.
The only thing that's certain in life is change, so to speak. So we have to live constant change. So the only thing. The uncertainty is what actually we can be sure about, and we can rely on that as a certainty, and it provides us with stability that we otherwise wouldn't have. But you can also look at things and say, well, yeah, but it's uncertain, so it's unstable. Well, no, not necessarily, if you know that it's always going to be that way, or that it always has been that way if we look at it historically. And so there is a certain amount of comfort that you can take from those things. And that's what a lot of esoteric thinkers tend to do. It's just like, okay, well, if everything's in flux, go with the flow. You know, embrace the flux, so to speak, or embrace that flow, or embrace that continuity of change, because then you have your continuity. You just have to be a little more alert than you would otherwise.
So the discussion is certainly relevant to today's world, because there are a large number of people who are trying to find some forms of certainty, and they're pulled towards these extremely, you know, the far right, if you like, that kind of thinking. And it comes back to the argument we had a long time ago about the relationship between conservation and conservatism.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
So that is a good point.
There's a sense where conservation is about looking for stability in a sense, or maintaining things the way they have always been as a form of stability, which is a kind of conservatism, right? So I don't know whether, Johnny, you have things to say. I'm sure you have things to say about that.
Yes, I certainly do. But Doug, did you want to chime in? I wanted to give everyone a chance to...
So are we certain that he's enigmatic and a Nazi at this point?
I am.
All right.
He got caught, that's all. Otherwise, we would never have known. Thanks.
So I guess the certainty also goes along with the context, in the sense that to be certain is to be within a certain context as well, or to remain in a certain context and be unwilling to recontextualize or seek elsewhere, perhaps, when other voices or contexts are coming in telling you otherwise. So yeah, I guess it comes down to character too. The enigmatic part, that's a character trait. So it flows into his philosophies, it flows into, or our philosophy, or whichever thinking we're thinking about. But these thoughts are coming from reading Bateson recently.
Yep.
So I understand how Bateson's coming into the picture, and kind of adding structure to the unstructurable, perhaps. I like the guy. He's still hard to read, and there's some long slogs in there, at least for me, that don't quite connect or make sense. And same can be said of Heidegger. I probably have read 12 essays or at least 12 pages of Being in Time, and I still don't have a good picture of what his philosophy is about. But I knew it, or I know it at some times, or I knew it at one time. I got it. So it's good to have that feeling there so I can follow along with the conversation. But yeah, that's all I want to say.
Thank you, Doug. I mean, we're going in so many different directions, and I'm glad you mentioned Bateson, because I think Bateson is Bateson could walk his talk, and I believe he operated in a very integral way, and which I can't say about Heidegger. I think that for his enormous talent, I don't think he integrated these enigmas. I think he was split apart by them. And I don't think he ever came quite together, although he had some brilliant insights, obviously, especially towards the end of his life. I think there's a very notorious interview that he gave, which is very suggestive of his psychic abilities that he had, you know, explored quite a bit. But I'm just about the excluded middle. And I saw the Miro show at MoMA, Museum of Modern Art, yesterday. And I posted a digital of the painting, Miro's painting, The Birth of the World. And of course, it's just a little picture, but the actual painting is about 12 feet tall. So it's a very different experience, the actual painting and the digital version that I posted in the thread. And I really do appreciate your response to that, Doug. I think it was a very creative response. But after seeing that particular image and sort of getting immersed in it, and you know how you walk through a gallery or through a museum and all of a sudden a painting just grabs you because it has an aura and it pulls you into it. And that was this, not all of his paintings had that effect on me, but this particular one did. And I just felt totally hypnotized by it. And it isn't captured in the digital image at all, the impact of the actual being in front of that canvas and feeling the gesture that's you intuit the gestures and the strokes and the kind of shimmering quality, the drippy quality of the paint. And as I went home, I got on my bike and I was driving home, not driving, I was riding my bike down Fifth Avenue. And I was very aware, after being in that world, being in another world, and aware of pedestrians and cab drivers and other bikers, all these people with all these different intentions and all these different destinations. And there I am, and it's a cold day and the sun is shining. So there's that, the warmth of the sun and the coldness of the temperature. And I'm moving on a bike through this traffic. And I decide to make a turn, and I see up ahead, I time it so that the light goes red so that I can cut across this lane, three lanes of traffic, and get across Broadway and then go home. And I stopped by the wine shop, got a bottle of wine, got a few groceries, and I'm walking down my street, which I've lived on for about 40 years. I'm recalling all of these images from previous incarnations on the street, what it looked like when I first arrived and what it looks like currently. And I'm wondering about all these different images. And as I walk through the hallway of my apartment, I live on the fifth floor walk up, I started to slow down. And I looked at the bricks and I looked at the wall and I looked at the peeling paint on the wall, and I imagined touching it before I touched it. And I got a sense of what will that feel like. And then I actually touched it. So I got a sensation of an imagined touch and an actual touch. And at this point, I felt like I was on drugs. I'm starting to float and I'm feeling like very, the absence of, I felt very present, but I felt an absence of what I would call an autobiographical self. It was much more of like a proto self than a core self or an autobiographical self. And I'm drawing on terminology by Antonio Damasio. Y'all may be familiar with him, a psychologist who talks a lot about these different kinds of selves that we can embody or separate from. But I felt when I went to bed, so did I show you this? This is what I'm drawing upon right now. The excluded middle. There's A and there's B. This comes right out of Bateson. And there's a line that separates A and B. A and B is not simply a matter of both A and B. The line between A and B is neither A nor B. So it is A-less and B-less, the line. This can be described as both A and B and neither A nor B. Welcome to the excluded middle. This is what fascinated Bateson. And what is a line anyway? This is a very deep question that mathematicians are wrestling with. And Giuseppe DeLongo, I'm reading him recently because he writes a lot on technology and the damaging effects of algorithms upon biological systems. He says a line is a thin imaginary nothing that separates something from nothing. It is a no thing that divides and then becomes perceived and conceived. So I'm just bringing all this up because I feel this tension between the perceived and the conceived, between perception and conception, is, you know, very, very core to our philosophical tradition. And the attempt to exclude that messy middle and how do we include it? And I think there are a lot of logicians who are trying to do that, to update this sort of Cartesian Aristotelian kind of logic. And I think we're doing this. Some of us are doing it and making a mess of things, and some of us are getting a little bit of clarity on occasion. I wanted to go into something else that happened, but I can press the pause button here. Because in our last conversation, there was some talk. Lisa was here. Of course, Lisa knows a lot about topology, and I learned a lot from her. And I think these topological spaces, like the Möbius strip and the Klein bottle and the ambiguity of these shapes, deeply fascinates me and resonates in a way that I resonated with the Miro yesterday. Because I believe they come, there's something from another dimension that is very familiar to me. And so I wanted to sort of riff on that. And what we were talking about last time, I think Doug was there as well as Ed, and we were talking about the digital and the analogical. And these are double, we operate with double codes, and they're absolutely necessary. That there be something static and inert that's digital and something that's active and moving, action-oriented, which is the analogical. And that we can do both at the same time is a profound mystery. And I think if we could become more aware of this mystery, we would be less prone to falling into the traps, I think, of this algorithmic mania, which does, according to Giuseppe Longo, who's a mathematician, great violence to biotic systems. And I think we're looking at, you know, all the possibilities, the wonderful things that could happen through this technology, and the horrible things that can happen. And Barrett has arrived. Hi, Barrett. Can you hear us? It looks like I don't know if you can hear us or not. Anyway, welcome. Maybe we'll do an intro. Can you hear me, Barrett? Just signaling. You can't. I can't hear you. You're on mute. Can you unmute yourself? You just muted yourself. I can't hear you. Maybe there's a microphone problem. Doug, once again, the human gap and technology is rearing its ugly head.
My only advice is to toggle around with the audio. I'm a horrible tech guy, so trial and error. We cannot hear your voice, but we can see you. And you can obviously hear us.
I can hear you now.
Okay, you can hear me now. Okay, great.
Yeah, great. Welcome.
Okay. Hi, everybody.
Yeah, good to have you.
Yeah, it's good to be here.
Barrett took you took the course with Davor, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
And I audited it. So I'm familiar with your face and your voice.
Yeah.
And I'm really glad you're here.
Yeah, I'm sorry I'm late. I've had a lot of sort of difficulty sort of navigating the digital space because I'm actually kind of new to forums. It's great to be here. Yeah, so I'm just basically here to listen to what you guys have to say about you're speaking about Davor's work, right? Layers of Generativity.
Yes, but he canceled today. We're going to reschedule hopefully next week.
Okay.
But we did. Some of us have been riffing on Heidegger in this particular.
Oh, okay.
And. We were also, I was just referencing a previous call that we had last week, and I think you mentioned that you saw it, where we were talking about the digital and the analogical and these different codes that we're operating with all the time. And some of the paradoxes and the impasses and the dilemmas that we sort of are having to deal with, because I think we get these, I'm talking about my personal experience, how confusing using these different codes can be.
Yes.
And I just mentioned having seen a Miro at the MoMA the other day, yesterday, this gigantic canvas. And then I looked for a digital image of it so I could post it on the forum, and how diminished that digital image is in comparison, that digitized image is compared to the actual power of the actual canvas in front of you, because it's really, really big. Anyway, I'm just riffing on that, so please feel free to chime in whenever you wish.
And are you touching on sort of, you know, sort of the neo-Heideggerian kind of object-oriented ontology stuff? Is that what you're sort of referencing, or?
Not really. I don't know Heidegger that well, but I'm a little bit more familiar with Deleuze and with what is philosophy, and with affects, and with concepts, and how he says basically philosophy is the creation of concepts. Art is about the creation of percepts. But obviously philosophy can do a little of both, and how that affective range is not the same thing as emotion. Emotions are more like stabilized affects. When you have anger or sorrow or joy or love, those you have labels that sort of ground something that's much more fluid and dynamic and pre-conscious. But I think these are the kinds of dilemmas and aporias or dilemmas, paradoxes that we get into. And I was just riffing on the Möbius strip and the Klein bottle, how these ambiguous figures seem to capture this, that twist in the Möbius strip where the inner and the outer are very vague or confusing or obscure. Yeah. And then we get in one world or the other world. And I just presented this little drawing, which I thought sort of suggested that A and the B are separated by a line.
Yeah.
But the line is neither A nor B. So the line is extremely ambiguous. And some of us are reading Bateson, who wrote a great deal on communication, some of these dilemmas that we get into when we try to exclude the middle. So anyway,
Have you read any of Deleuze's stuff on Francis Bacon?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, I have.
Good stuff. But with Inside and Outside, I actually think I've been thinking a lot about this and sort of its political implications, because one of the biggest problems we're having right now is that because of this inability to sort of break through, you know, I understand that this generative ways of cognition that DeVore is talking about, it's almost a given, right? You know, which is, I think Ed was kind of saying this, but I think it's important to intimate these things just because a lot of people aren't thinking this way, because we're having a real problem where we're not actually looking and delineating what's the true inside and what's the true outside. And a lot of people can't see that today. You're seeing it politically. And I guess some of my own politics, I try to be reflective of this as somebody who's invested in investigating the outside, which is, you know, so I think it's important to like impede this notion of what is an insider and what is an outsider. And I think today we're having a really hard time seeing that, because there's a set of ideological givens and sort of academia and sort of Marxist academia, leftist academia, that's basically strangulating the discourse on what we can obtain as a means of seeing things represented in the outside. And to me, I think that's a big problem. And we're seeing that politically right now with this kind of bipolarity left-right thing. And DeVore and me sort of agree that left-right distinction has kind of outlived itself, you know? So, and I think that's a good place to kind of, at least in a practical way, to start there, because I'm just seeing a lot of stuff, frankly, it's just bullshit and I don't like it. And I'm kind of like, One of the great things I saw, I've been checking out about this group, is that you guys tend to actually acknowledge that. And a lot of other groups, they don't want to push to those limits. They don't want to push to those places and say, oh, no, 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 this is as far as I can go while still maintaining some level of acceptability with whether, you know, it's metaphysic, whether it's political. And there's a set of ethical kind of givens. And I think, you know, I'm not ragging against humanism, or, you know, I think inhumanism can be kind of crazy when you're talking about machine learning, you know, and I think that you make a very strong point. And one of the things that the sort of new trend of neo-rationalism is trying to do is it's trying to erase the metaphysical condition.
Thank you. Is there anything about neo-rational? Because I really would love to hear you elaborate on that if you'd like.
You know, it's the sort of kind of, and like I said, I think that there are important things about it. Like, I don't want to rag too much on, you know, Reza Negarastani's new book, Intelligence and Spirit, which is sort of like a big hit in the sort of para philosophy world. And I think it makes a lot of really great points. But one of the things I'm always stricken with is this kind of, is the sort of place of Sellers foundationalism, how what is taken as foundationalism, which is, and sort of like these subliminal acts or graspings that belie notions of concept and idea, and how those manifest themselves as like what's good for humans, right? Like with the neo-rationalism, there's never any, and I don't mean to be some like, I'm not suggesting postmodern constructivism is the way either. I'm saying that there has to be a reason why these things are supposed to function the way they are. And they just kind of take themselves as like, well, this is rational, therefore it's just. Okay, but there's not really, there's got to be something other than that, which is why I think with what DeVore is saying and what you're saying is that the metaphysics, sometimes they need to be almost a precondition as well. It can't all just be pure materialism, pure scientific rationalism, because, like, let's take, for example, and this is one of the problems with the Marxist thought, is like history can only progress if the present is the perfect condition to make that happen. And when you look at the sort of second, third, fourth order culture, things don't have to be perfect in order to naturally blossom. History doesn't have to look a certain way that you want it to, because in many fact, we can actually look at history and say, hey, well, this was my ideology and this was my way of looking, and the stars, they all seemed to line up, but it didn't yield the result that I wanted. And many times it doesn't, you know? And so we have to account for those things down the road, you know, instead of just this kind of, you know, reductive way of looking at time and history and cognition, you know. And I think that once we get into that sort of place, we tread into some very dangerous waters. And this is why I actually think DeVore is important. And, you know, as Deleuze said, the main, you know, he said one of the main things about a philosopher is that you're there to impede stupidity. You're not there to just come up with new ideas all the time. You have to impede the stupid ideas that are permeating around you and the dangerous ideas. And I think there's a lot of really dangerous ideas coming from this sort of, whether it's like the identitarian left or it's this sort of, you know, ultra pragmatist, anti-liberal sort of materialism. I think that these things, they have legs. And a lot of people want to brush this stuff off like, oh, you know, these are invisible groups and they don't have any influence. It's like, well, let's look at the New Zealand shooter referenced accelerationism in his manifesto. I mean, so this is some supposedly fringe you know, aesthetic, philosophical project, but it, you know, these things have legs, and even though, you know, we those people may not get that personal credit from an ego position, these ideas, they still carry somewhere, and so we have to be aware of the way in which they carry and try to guide these things, you know.
Yeah.
So this is, that's just kind of where I'm coming from.
That's great. Thank you, Barrett. I was I really appreciate your bringing up Reza Negrestani and his new book. I've not looked at yet, but I've listened to a lot of his talks, and he references Wilfred Sellers and the manifest image and the scientific image. Some of you guys may be familiar with that. Some of us, we haven't really talked about Sellers and that, but I think positivism is something most of us have railed against at one time or another. And basically Sellers is, I think, a spokesperson for a form of positivism. And I believe this new materialisms and some very interesting thinkers are trying to revisit and update a kind of crude materialism, which most materialists are sort of jumping off of that ship because it doesn't work, but they don't know what to replace it with. And I think some of us have studied Gebser, Jean Gebser, who's a cultural critic who talked about the integral, a new phase, which he says is an octave, a higher octave of the magical, the mythical, and the rational, and that the rational, deficient forms of the rational, there's efficient and deficient forms. And I believe a lot of the new materialism is trying to become an efficient form of materialism, of the mental structure. Right before perhaps this leap into what a lot of theorists like Gebser was calling the integral or the aperspectival, where right now, I think the current materialisms are suppressing and rejecting and have a phobia for the magical and the mythical.
Oh, yeah.
Which really screws up the rational, because the rational rides upon those previous structures.
Yeah, exactly.
And so that's what I think Gebser was recognizing. And
yeah, I've seen that. Well, that's the problem with this kind of Solarzian orthodoxy is that it wants to obliterate through almost a sort of scientism that's kind of totalitarian in a sense, the sort of metaphysical condition, but it never really answers the question, why is this materialism the correct materialism? Why is this, and I think, but I'm not going to say that it's not an interesting proposition. And I think it's something important to entertain. I think it's something to take really seriously. Like, I take these people seriously. Like, I take Brassier seriously. Like, Reza, I take very seriously. I just don't necessarily agree, because when you talk about the mystical, and a lot of these people, they came from the Deleuze camp, and they sort of rejected this kind of like transcendental, I guess you would almost say transcendental materialism, and so it's almost like, I don't want to make up too paint in too broad of strokes, but it almost seemed to be that, you know, this kind of transcendental materialism got misconstrued by a lot of kids in liberal arts colleges, and they didn't like the way that it became quote unquote trendy. So they reacted against this, but I'm like, wait, no. There's still things here we can pull from. This is still important, you know, like, let's talk about, like, for example, like the whole thing with universal basic income. Like, a lot of these people are like, well, you know, it's not the perfect material condition. It's like, no, but we can actually, if you actually chart and see that the way in which this has an effect on the brain, just the fact that you have something in your bank account,
right,
can actually manifest the change necessary for some kind of like economic or human progression. And a lot of this sort of like antiquated state socialist kind of political people and Marxists are saying, well, no, it's not perfect because it's not enough. It's not this, it's not that, it's not, it's always hinging on a set of givens that isn't, that's always conditioned first off by this kind of like idea of scientific rationality, and second by just pure ideology, and you're just conflating the two and jumbling them all up together. But in order for us, but if we can see that, you know, I guess it's something like when you have no money in your bank account, your IQ drops by 13 points or something like that. You make irrational decisions. People become more bigoted because you have nothing and you see somebody as something and they're like, I'm going to blame the other. I'm going to, whether who, no matter who it is, you're going to blame somebody else for your problems when that's not the root of the problem. And you're starting to see that now. And if we can alleviate that, then the change can happen, but there's a metaphysics to that itself. And so this is kind of what I'm kind of going up against with a lot of people that I know, you know, at least I've met or people I've sort of spoken with, you know, is that these things are still important, you know, and they don't have to be perfect. They just have to set you on a path, you know.
Yes, I am. You're talking about universal basic income.
Yeah.
And what are we going to do with the surplus? And the old left, the stale Marxist rhetoric or the laissez-faire politics, that old,
yeah,
the old
like battles
between, yeah, the battles between the left and the right.
Yeah, I don't like
also
it.
Also the battles between the top and the bottom.
Yeah.
I think that's coming forward also, that,
oh,
that
totally.
most people are on the bottom.
Yeah. Oh, I know.
And what happens to the body-brain relational field when so many are at the bottom and yeah. so few are at the top? And that, I think, is what's interesting about Devor as we start moving out of this, the current economy of, you know, capitalism, globalism.
Yeah.
Maybe something called, some are calling the planetary, which is very different from the globalization. How can we think about or imagine a post-money world? And I felt that was such a daunting task. I didn't even want to bother going there. But I thought, well, maybe if I could present a little bit about what I found so valuable about Devor's work.
Yeah.
And we did an interview with him. We had a previous discussion about him, and maybe if he come, and I wanted him to view our discussion about him so that we could start looking at meta, going to a meta perspective on this so that our group could get feedback from him, which is what he offered to do. He offered to come and join us and he could give us feedback on our feedback. So I believe we could start closing some of these loops rather than leaving them open, which I think is what's bad about this technology, is that we open up a lot of loops and we never close any of them. So we don't integrate anything. We more diversity is great if you can integrate that diversity, and then it creates stability. If there's no integration, more diversity is only going to fuck us up. So I think that's the difference between the postmodern and yeah. the integral.
I agree.
It's not just about celebrating diversity for its own sake. It's about
how much of this can we integrate?
Exactly.
Yeah.
So that's, I think, part of the challenge. And how then can we use our imaginations in ways that we recognize we're in the past of that anterior future that may be a post-money future? And a flourishing future for many more of us than there are in this current reality that we're in. And we're not going to get there without the imagination. We're not going to get there without new subjectivities and new metaphysics. So I think the neo-materialists who want to ban metaphysics, you know, and say, oh, we're post-metaphysical now, are just bullshitting everybody because they're promoting a form of the most atrocious kind of dogmatism, you know? Well, they're doing metaphysics, but it's
Reza actually has acknowledged this when I sort of asked him about this. He's like, when you actually, so there has been sort of an amendment to where there can be an account for these sort of meta positions and these metaphysic positions, because at a certain point you're going to have to realize that that as in history, as they've tried to ban metaphysics, it only created a stronger form of dogmatism in metaphysics. I mean, and so I think that I think there is an acknowledgement of that, but it still doesn't necessarily answer the question of how do we then, given the prescription of this world, you know, the thing about the sort of new materialisms is it's by trying to erase meta theory, they're trying to reconstruct new universals. But these new universals, they're still coming from fragments of the old world in which we live in. So at the end of the day, you're going to need the imagination and you're going to need these things in order to move us beyond the sort of picking up the pieces and sort of refashioning them into this new world. It's like, you know, it's like, so we have like a chair, but what good is a chair if we just take a leg and we put it up here and then we put it there and it's sticking out of the side, you know, because we think it's interesting. We think it's an interesting experiment because we're looking at these sort of theories myopically in order to create new forms of universality. But I think we really, and this is why I think DeVore is right, is because we actually need to use our imaginations. We need to sort of transcend these things in order to actually have this stuff work. We can't just say, sit there and look at something and play with these abstractions forever and ever and ever, because we can just do that, you know? But if we actually are opening our eyes and in tune with some sort of vibrational force.
It is vibration.
And then we can actually do something. We can actually move forward because we're not beholden to these sort of tiny little tools in our lab where we're actually trying to, you know, it could take forever in order to reconfigure this thing, but you're still picking up the same pieces. Like, you want to destroy the world, but you're still resurrecting it from the same world. Right. And I think that's, and they acknowledge that, but we're, you know, but I think we can go further than that. And at least if we're not going further, it can be less dangerous in my own personal position, because we have to ask ourselves, like, what kind of world do we want to live in? Do you want to live in my world? Do you want to live in a neo-rationalist world? Do I want to live in John's world? Do I want to live in Doug's world? You know, so, you know, we have to take these temporalities into account and see that we are, like, as we walk down the street, we're existing in almost different civilizational capacities with people we see. I mean, I live in L.A., I walk down the street and there are kids who are only 12 years younger than me. And it's like, they live in the civilizational gap between me and someone who's 18 years old is so incredibly wide. It's like, how do I integrate that? You know, I mean, I'm 32 and I'm having a hard time figuring these kids out, you know, it's so seriously.
Yeah, I think that's fascinating. And some of the gossip that some of the scandals that are happening right now with this, the college admission scandal, and with Jussie Smollett, who's a black gay, very popular, you know, entertainer, who staged his own a racial attack on himself. And he's evidently been exposed and is going to go to jail. And I think that those who fabricated this college admissions thing, very wealthy, successful people, trying to get their kids into school, spent tons of money doing it. And it's fascinating to me how this this kind of social schizophrenia is sort of deeply embodied in so many people. And I think we're seeing that 1% who have gotten away with quite a bit. I think this technology is taking away their security blankets. They've ranted and railed about affirmative action, but here they are in this brand new world where we're seeing these highly privileged people buying their way, buying access to stuff that they're not entitled to. And in that process, they're bumping people off into a limbo. Yeah. And I think that who are deserving of a break, but they've been disenfranchised and disempowered, even though they've done the work and have the smarts. So I think these are the kind of, this is really fascinating to me, how we're dealing with these, the shadow side, which I believe our technology is ironically starting to expose even more. So it's out of their control.
Yeah.
To a large extent.
Well, this is why I try to not take this kind of like, and this is one thing that I will say about, at least in my reading of the kind of neo-rationalist, new materialist schools, their interests on a practical level are very much in line, because they, you know, like they know bullshit when they see it. Like they're trying to identify the true outside and the true inside as well. And they're trying to identify an intermediate stage between those two things to create, instead of this bipolarity situation we're seeing on a social and sociological level, trying to figure out a new unipolarity. Like I think the intention is actually similar, you know. Like I don't think, you know, when we're seeing Jussie Smollett, this is what I'm talking about, this conflation of inside and outside, where it's like, if you can stage this kind of hoax, I mean, in the 1960s, you couldn't do that. You know, I mean, you couldn't do something like that. That, you know, so obviously there's a type of leverage that you have, you know, based on this kind of like identity politics stuff, to where you can, there's power to gain. And the thing is, if you already have that material power, like you're already a part of the 1%, we're seeing a lot of these college students who are kind of like identifying as these kind of like, you know, neo-Maoist revolutionaries, but it's like you're literally a part of the oppressing class. Like you know, you've never worked in a factory. I've worked in a factory, you know.
Me too. It sucks.
I've been homeless. Like, you know, it's like, so in a lot of these people who are on the margins who are experiencing these things, they're not actually actively getting the platform in order to discuss that, because the privileged are always going to be the ones saying, hey, this is the way it is, and you're a part of this X, Y, and Z, and all this sort of like Frankfurt School stuff, you know, which is basically like conflating the postmodern condition with this kind of stale, stagnant overgeneralization. And saying, hey, this is just the way that it is, and it's not going to change. And it's like, you need to update your theories. You need to update the way that you see the world, because we're not identifying, and most of us are on the outside, and it's going to continue to grow unless we are able to navigate this. And I hate to use that word navigate, but if we're going to figure this out, we have to be bold and actually talk about these things. And we can't be afraid, because we're not going to be able to get the outside, and the sort of margins aren't going to be able to have what they need. Right. You know, and it's a dire situation, you right. know, it's serious, you know? So if we don't look and use our imagination for post-capitalism, instead of listening to these kind of like ideologues who don't really know what they're talking about, and we don't use our imagination, we're not going to figure this thing out. Right. It's going to be too late, you know? And the great thing about the slot matrix and technology is it is helping expose these people. It's helping expose a lot of charlatans. At the same time, there is a, you know, it is sort of a method of control, you know, and it's a method of sort of, so it is an apparatus of control, and it's a, because it's this form of surveillance, and you see with a kind of doxing and the way in which the state can sort of like, you know, we look at the sort of platforms, they're basically just agents for advertisement, so they can codify all of our interests and resell it and repackage it and sell it back to us, you know. So there's that apparatus of it too. There's that side of it, and then there's the side that's kind of a little, that can actually expose transparency, but it's not going away. So how do we leverage it, you know?
I just wanted to open this up to
the, I didn't speak too much. So.
No, it was great. I think you've given us a lot, and I'm really enjoying this sort of a cross-fertilization between different groups, because I've been very drawn to a lot of the persons who are working at the center, including yourself and Dave Orr and Reza, but I've only been dipping into the archives and at my leisure and taking notes. And I'm interested in these sort of, how can groups who are sort of how can we triangulate from the margins with all of this technology we have at our fingertips, literally, when it works. Sometimes it doesn't work. And sure, someone may be collecting data on us, and I'm sure they are, but what's the difference between that and what we're doing here? And the warm data, as Nora Bateson talks about, which they're not collecting. They don't think that's important. They're just collecting our shopping behaviors.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, so
have any money, you're not shopping that much, let me tell you.
Yeah, they're not, they don't, whatever's going on here, it's not being focus group right now. So we can see, right. So there's a security to that, you know?
Right. So I'm wanting to invite other people to chime in whenever if there's something you want to add, or because we were riffing on Heidegger previous to this, and the question concerning technology, and what we've been talking about, these new metaphysics and the new subjectivities that are starting to emerge. And I think what Devo was saying, we're already doing this in that article which we read on distributing a potentiality. We're already doing this, so let's do it on purpose, is sort of, I think, what his invitation is to recognize that we're moving towards this, what he's calling a second order culture. And because many people, that old identity which was wrapped up in employer employee dynamics is vanishing, since many people are just working from gig to gig, from paycheck to paycheck. That whole idea is pretty much already gone from many, many people after the last recession, especially, which is like 10 years ago, which many people never recovered from. And so they don't have an identity caught up in that. Let's go to the best school we can, and let's graduate, and let's go out and work on Wall Street. sort of ridiculous. And I think a lot of people don't have a vision yet that they can replace that what I would call the sinister American dream that so many people in my generation certainly were conflicted about. In the 60s, there was a great deal of backlash against the 50s. And then the 70s and the 80s and the 90s, you had Reaganomics and you had trickle down and you had Margaret Thatcher. And, you know, I think we're seeing how that sort of that neoliberal grid is sort of breaking up now in very dramatic and spectacular ways, but it can go in many different directions, obviously. Yeah. So I'm really opening up this to the floor to everybody, as many voices as want to chime in. Thank you.
I don't have too much to say, nor do I want to impede on anyone else that has something to say, but I'm interested in a phrase in the last section of Davor's English summary that he provided that I think all of us have read to the end here, maybe not Jeffrey, but at the end he somewhat concludes or state, which I don't have in front of me, I'm out in the middle of nowhere, but he talks of UBI and social credit score and something else, a hybrid or a mix of these ways of proceeding in the world, perhaps. It's already being implemented in certain areas. In the last conversation, we talked about social credit score in China. We don't, obviously, that's probably not what Davor is thinking about. So I wouldn't mind hearing more about that at some point, because that does interest me. We have a presidential candidate that's running on a UBI platform. So I'm wondering how that would come about. But there seems to be various interests in all sorts of fields, which can be implemented, but not at the current rate we're going. So like you say, we need to impede the stupidity. But when we do have these trials, how would that come into play without just staying back and observing it from afar? How do we actually put it into action without it affecting others or causing more stupidity? That's a question I have.
Well,
I'm interested. I want to see if TJ had anything to add. I don't know if he can stay the rest of the time, so I wanted to give him a chance to speak.
Thanks.
I'm fighting with my camera here. Can you guys hear me?
Yes, we hear you.
Hi, Barrett. Nice to meet you, man.
Nice to meet you.
I was thinking of the same thing that actually Doug had, well, toward the end of Loeffler's distributing potentiality essay. Currently, the structure, this is the last paragraph, currently the structure of economy can only be sketched out in broad strokes, since it will appear as an emergent layer growing out of the abstractions of the currently developed technologies. And he had that last phrase italicized. What had struck me, he's seeing this as an outgrowth of what already is, according to how he's worded that. Universal basic income. I'm trying to connect the two actually in my head. How do we get there from here? Which I guess is Doug's broader question. Oh, I'm sorry, that was the question.
Could you repeat that, TJ, the question?
We were talking about imagination. We're talking about universal basic income. We're talking about, you know, one of our would-be, Pearson's running for president is going to be running on that kind of platform.
Can I ask you about something? You mentioned in the interview with Davor that Doug and I did, that you heard Davor say, outside rather than outside. And I just thought that was really interesting that you misheard something, and you knew that you'd misheard it, but it was extremely suggestive. And that's why I was sort of drawn to that, TJ, in your, and you shared some stuff in the forum that I thought was very interesting. Anyway, if there's something you wanted to, if there's something else about that, I would be open to hearing that as well as anyone who wants to respond to what you just asked about the outgrowth of what already is. Thanks.
I have a question. The current political economic regime, if you will, is hell-bent on destroying welfare, the social safety net. And it's not real clear to me what's the difference between a universal basic income and welfare.
Could you, are you asking me or just anybody in general?
So my summary would be that it's...
We're in a group discussion.
Yeah. No, it's a good question because I guess that's what I was trying to get to. If we're going to imagine a second order culture, which I'm all for, I guess it behooves us to remember how ingrained the first order culture is in everything we've been taught to think and believe about ourselves. You know, I mean, it's a structure of consciousness, and you kind of don't, Gebser is very clear, you kind of don't mutate to another structure of consciousness without serious crises. Now, definitely there's crises on the horizon, definitely. I was just wondering, and I guess that's what the group is kind of figuring out. How do we build a planetary consciousness to get out of this crisis?
Yeah. Well, one thing that one quote from, you know, he's kind of a controversial guy, Michel Houellebecq, French writer. He wrote, civilizations, they don't merely die, they actively commit suicide. And that's something that I kind of am almost in agreement with, and we're kind of seeing that right now. So it's like when we look at things, you know,
Toynbee had the same idea.
Yeah, exactly. In sort of distributing potentiality, and I think a lot of what DeVore's talking about, you know, we can say, well, what's the difference between welfare and UBI? That's a really good question. I mean, essentially, on a practical level, the idea would almost be that the UBI is credited against sort of like state welfare, so it becomes its own form of like, you know, I don't want to say like it's a form of economic determinism as sort of like this neoliberal welfare system has kind of like failed us, even if materially these things may not shift. And one of the things I was really skeptical about universal basic income is the idea of market inflation, because you're not just going to regulate these corporations. If there's no making these private monopolies public in some sense, at least regulating the hell out of them, then UBI is just worthless. Then you're going to have some sort of recursive neoliberal problem. So how do we manage this to protect these things? And then it comes all the way down to sort of restrictions. And we have to look at the current system that we have now and say, well, if automation is heading in this direction, we're trending towards this direction, what can the state do? What can the people do? What can a democracy do to sort of offset this sort of neoliberal market forces that are kind of subsuming everything and everyone, you know? And so that's always going to be the precondition to any form of social welfare. You know, that's why we have to actually look at those things. And then what happens later, UBI, you have a president running on a UBI platform. Well, I actually really support him, but it's the creation of the metaphysics. It's the creation, even if it's a fabrication of a new system, it's still going to lead you to open these things up in a different way. It's like, say Hillary Clinton had won the nomination over Donald Trump, we wouldn't be asking a lot of the same questions. We just bomb a bunch of other countries and just kind of most people would sit there and leave it at that. You know, we continue on this sort of neoliberal trajectory and that would be it. But we're not. But even if we didn't get what we wanted, it still opened us up to ask these kinds of questions. And this precondition comes from imagination. And I think, you know, people can look at DeVore's text, which I think is an extraordinary text personally, but it's opening us up to these imaginative, magical forces. And people want to write off myth in our world, in our life. And they want to, and you just can't write off mythology. You can't just write these things off, you know? And I think there's an underlying force that's so much stronger than any kind of, you know, and people, and you don't want to tread into skepticism or, you know, these kind of wild conspiracy theories and these kind of, you know, heliocentric view of the world and like gods and all this stuff, but you want to be able to take that stuff into account, because there's a metaphysical proposition to this materialism as well. And so I think it's important to entertain these things just on a mimetic level, because then we're going to be shifting down the line, and I don't think people can stop it. I think as soon as the mimetics hit, I think it's already determined. There's already a set of determinism that's going to actually lead this to happen anyway. I don't think people can stop it. So I'm like, how do we guide this thing? I'm done.
Yeah, that's great, Barrett. I'm just wanting to back up a little bit. We talked about the bigger yams that got bigger and bigger and bigger, and people who made the biggest yams got rewarded by their culture. And then of course the yams lost their nutritional value. And we were talking about systems in transition and how the shared symbols in our culture, like the gross national product, are all driven by fossil fuels, which we're running out of, agribusiness, and the topsoils are collapsing, and the death of the oceans. This is the kind of noise. Of course, the noise can be a signal. And I think that's some people have been paying attention to this for a very long time. I mean, Bateson was talking about this, and so was Eisenhower, when he talked about the military-industrial complex and how dangerous it was. And he was a leading general in the Second World War. So with all of that, Laurie, and we're talking about the safety net, which is being abolished, the austerity measures that have been implemented after the big, you know, the meltdown that happened, generated by Wall Street. And now we're looking at Lori Loughlin, an actress, multimillionaire, who just spent $500,000 to get her two daughters into USC. And she succeeded with the help of this nefarious character who has pleaded guilty and has exposed a network, an underground network of the super wealthy who are gaming the system. So I believe as we talk about the austerity measures and the safety net and a guaranteed income, and on one hand, and look at this kind of charade that is ongoing in, you know, what some would call the 1%. And we're looking at the coral reef that's dying. And we're looking at, you know, we're getting all kinds of feedback and from different kinds of scales. And out of that, we have to construct some sort of compelling enough future for us to work together towards something like a vision. And they say in the Bible, the people perish without a vision. And traditionally, there's been a ruling elite which has been able to use their imaginations through various ways. Could be soothsayers, it could be, you know, astrology or whatever, but they could imagine and predict and to some extent control events and implement a plan that enough people were then compelled in some ways to comply with. And I think this is what Dave Orr is pointing out, that it's not about the means of production anymore and that old leftist neo-Marxist crap. But we're moving towards something that is, as we eliminate through automation, cashiers and bank tellers and, you know, people who are in the manufacturing sector, as those jobs are being eliminated and not replaced. We're also looking at the middle management and the CEOs. There's a little purpose for them as well. So they're a slot in the matrix, and that's starting to unravel. And we're all just, and many of us just have, who have jobs, they're bullshit jobs, and we know it. But, you know, there are probably very good reasons for maintaining a job, even if it's a bullshit job. And I think we're in a transition, and it's a phase space we're entering into, and a liminal zone, if you will. And it's unprecedented complexity. And when we have complex, unstable systems such as this one, best practices just will not work. Best practices that are set up for a much simpler kind of system than the one we're in now. And traditionally, and I think this is something that Dave was studying, historically, during these big transformations, these kinds of best practices don't work, but there's a lot of creativity and innovation and thinking outside of the box and new kinds of imagination, new kinds of subjectivities, new kinds of metaphysics. And I believe we've done that before. We'll have to do it again, I think, on a much bigger scale than we've ever had to before, simply because this kind of complexity is actually quite unprecedented. But also, we have access to a lot of information we never had access to before. So I think this is the big challenge we're all up against. And, you know, we are oscillating quite a bit, you know, between extremes. And then I think we all are sort of having to try to make sense as well as make some meaning. But I think we can't make much sense if we're not, we can't make much meaning, as Nora Bateson says, unless we can make some sense. And I think this is what's challenging for us, that the disconnect between the perceptual and the conceptual. And I think the conceptual spaces can get pretty dry and very arid and very far away from the street very quickly. I think this is the challenge. Anyway, that's so my
spiel. I wanted to come back to Ed's question about guaranteed income versus welfare. So maybe I'm going to say something that's very obvious. So you can just tell me to shut up if it's that obvious. But so I work in the field of disability, and in terms of people have this sort of general idea that okay, it's a good thing that people with disability have access to the environment in which through which they move. So we should put into place a few mechanisms that allow this to occur. That's the kind of the general, I think, understanding of how to deal with disability. But it's not actually the way it works in a number of important ways, because in fact the basic human rights of disability is that governments are required to give people with disability access to full social participation. It's written into the law of the land and has been for the last 10 years or so. And so in different ways, in the United States, it's the American Disabilities Act, but Canada has its own variations, which aren't organized the same way, but they are still necessary, still in the law of the land. And so this sort of common idea that one can provide some sort of mechanisms to allow this to occur, but we won't worry too much about it, is wrong. It's not the way we've actually, across the planet, installed a structure. Now, the problem, of course, is having the structure in place does not mean it's enforced, and enforcing these access is actually now the problem, not the legal requirements which are in place, but enforcing these legal requirements is now the big challenge in disability. Well, to me, the discussion around guaranteed income is related to this. Guaranteed income, guaranteed access to the world is, so it's a kind of version of guaranteed access for people with disability. Guaranteed ability to participate fully in society is for everybody, not just for people with disability. And income is obviously a big component, and it's a big issue in the world of disability as well. How do you because people with disability are systematically poorer than people without disability, and so there are issues around economic accessibility for people with disability. But of course, the same arguments apply to everybody, not just to people with disabilities. So the welfare system is clearly not organized in the same way around this idea of responding to a basic human need for access, or hey, and not just need, but legally mandated requirement. And so our own systems are inconsistent in regard to this, because in a way, a guaranteed income is responding to the legal requirements that we have in place in a more full way. So I think the guaranteed income is much closer to the spirit of the law, but the welfare is close to the letter of the law as it is actually implemented. And that's the kind of dilemma that we're faced with as a society. Now, I'm not trying to say that all the other issues aren't there, the technology issues and the social issues, the industrial complex and all the rest of it. But I do think that the issue about rights is somehow fundamental to this discussion. So,
yeah, I would totally agree with that. I work in disabilities myself, actually, and it's always a war between the regulations and the resources.
Can I ask you something? The war between regulation and resources and disabilities. I've worked with the disabled as well and the elderly. Is there, and the guaranteed income and the state welfare, is there a relationship between all that and fraud? Like the one that Lori Lachman committed. Why is it that a multimillionaire will spend $500,000 to fraudulently get their two kids into a college? And many, of course, are getting away with this, or have gotten away with this. I'm just thinking there is a relationship between the is there a relationship between that terrible welfare cheat and the billionaire frauds? You know, it seems like the more money in the bank, the more willing they are to risk a great deal in order to get more fraudulent behavior. So I'm just wondering about this. I don't have an answer to it, but it just seems to me that we want to build a wall, you know, the border with Mexico, we want to build a wall. And I think with Brexit, you're seeing all kinds of defensive behaviors. And we're looking at the crisis of refugees and, you know, how the biggest polluters have actually created the conditions whereby large numbers of refugees are coming to our borders because of the conditions that have been created by some of these largest polluters on the planet. And so I believe we're going to really have trouble with boundaries and what's the inside and what's the outside. And every boundary has an inside and an outside. At the biological level, at the cellular level, our tissues and our organs and our organisms and our environments, there are very subtle discriminations at the biological level. And I believe that's happening at our social level as well, and our culture, at the cultural level. There are insides and our outsides. And there are those topological, those in that Mobius strip, the inside and the outside becomes extremely paradoxical. So anyway, that's my spiel.
Can I add something?
Please.
How many of these celebrity cases or otherwise where bribery and the fraudulent behavior, how many of those happened in public institutions?
I think we're talking about Yale and Harvard and
right. Which are private.
USC. So. They're about 500. I think that 50 people have been charged.
That's okay. This
building means that there are about 500 right. to 800 right. people involved. Yeah.
Right. They're all private institutions. They're not public institutions. Now, we had a president, a couple of presidents ago, who could barely read and write, who was, for most of us, the bottom of the barrel when it came to intellectual capabilities. And this man had a degree from Yale and an MBA from Harvard.
Right, right.
Well, how did he get into one of those schools?
Right.
He did not have the qualifications to get there. But in all of the Ivy League schools, and I would say that the Ivy League schools are a model for most private institutions anyway, you have a program of legacies. So 60%, if not more, of all of this incoming freshman class, those slots will be occupied by people, fathers and mothers, who have gone to that school before.
Right.
So what you've done is you've narrowed the open enrollment part to about 25 to 40% of the student population in any given year. Now, we also know that one of the chief advisors to the current president of the United States, Jared, also went to Yale. And his father donated $2.5 million to Yale. And all of a sudden, his child got in. But he wasn't charged with fraud. Mm-hmm. He didn't bribe anyone. And in 1986, I remember, it was one of my, because it's such a funny movie, Rodney Dangerfield played in a movie called Back to School.
Oh, yeah. That's great.
Where he donated the business school and was also admitted to the college, which was an obvious case of fraud, if you will, but it's not fraud because it was a donation. So I ask myself, why are we chastising people who think that they're entitled to things for things that other people do, the same thing in a different way, but then it is not any kind of a criminal act. And well, from the get-go, and what is that? And there are a certain number of slots at Harvard, Yale, and all of the Ivy League and the private institutions that are open for competitive admissions. And some of those are automatically set aside for affirmative action kind of things. I'm not saying good, bad, or indifferent. I'm just saying it's a very structured and regulated environment. And because somebody came along and tried to push their way to the front of the line in that particular instance, I find it a little disingenuous to start accusing them of doing great wrongs where other people there's a right way to do it. The only thing that they can be accused of, I believe, is stupidity. If Lori Loughlin had gone there and said, I would like to donate a wing to the humanities.
Yeah, it's the underlying power structure.
Library, she would have got in.
No, there's a difference in philanthropy and donating creating a library, John, and then letting your kid.
Yeah. John, excuse me for interrupting. Right. But when you are catering to a private institution, philanthropy is not involved. Philanthropy is, for me, in my understanding, something that is for the public good, not for a private good. You are going to a private institution, and you are enriching a private institution in some way so that they will be more disposed to behave favorably to you. That's why I asked originally, how many of these instances came up with public institutions?
Yeah, now, that's a quid pro quo from the beginning.
Yes, exactly. That's my point. And so I understand that these things are, they make for good news, you know, and it's really interesting to see them, but I'm not real clear on what's the actual problem. This has been going on forever. It's nothing new.
Well, let me just add a little layer to this, because it's not, I mean, philanthropy, where people donate to an institution, an education institution, a library, for instance, and then their kids get to go to that school. That's pretty open. But what was happening in this case was she gave $500,000 to get SAT scores changed, to get her kids photoshopped to look like athletes, which they were not. And the money went into a phony tax. They got tax deductions because they funneled it into a phony institution run by this guy, this nefarious character who's, you know, basically confessed that the organization that he was basically just laundering money actually for these people so they could get tax write-offs. And I think it's odd that they got caught, but they did get caught. Yeah, and now I'm watching on YouTube these young women, and I never watched these young women in college, and they're furious by Olivia Jade, the daughter who got in and who had all of these, who was called an influencer. Her YouTube channel had like 2 million people subscribed to it. And of course, all of the institutional support that she was getting from, you know, the cosmetic companies, because she was a sort of glamorous and attractive young woman, they want to cut ties with her really, really fast. So it's just fascinating, I think, how quickly they can rise and fall. And I think that's going to happen a lot more because of there are people who, you know, are using this technology in ways that are, you know, unprecedented. So I think I'm not hopeful about, I'm just saying there's a relationship, I think, between fraud and the welfare, people who are on welfare, and how people are saying affirmative action is a benefit, that we have diversity, because diversity creates stability. And when we have lack of diversity, it creates great instability. And I think we're seeing more and more of the unstable than we are the stable in our current regime. So anyway, I'm putting that out there.
Well,
I don't have a solution to any of this, by the way.
Well, I think it's kind of interesting talking about affirmative action because, you know, I'm a quarter Athabascan Indian. My mom is half. She grew up she was in a village and with a dirt floor, and she used affirmative action. She was on affirmative action board, and she graduated from an Ivy League school. She went to Dartmouth, you know. I had horrible grades in high school. I mean, I was just like a problem child, and here I was getting scholarships to, you know, 15 different schools that were way beyond me even having any interest in partaking in these things. So I decided, you know, I was going to use this opportunity, which it was an opportunity, to go to art school. So I went to CalArts. And as soon as I get there, what they say is, you know what? Like, look at me. I have blonde hair, blue eyes. I don't look like what I am, even though I'm registered. You know, I have my card. I have, you know, I have everything. I have a say in my regional tribal affairs, you know, up in Alaska, where my mom is from. Yet they wanted me to make identity art. They said, well, you know, since you got in here, you have to make us look good by being the token Indian of this institution that, you know, had ties to the CIA and was started as a basically a corporate shell company for the Disneys. You're gonna be our, you know, humanizing, you're gonna be part of the humanizing face, you know, and all of your experience sort of, which, you know, I spent a lot of time on the Yukon River in my grandmother's fish camp, fishing, no electricity in the summers. You know, setting up nets, waking up at 5 a.m., reading comic books, you know, playing with fish guts for fun. You know, when I was in high school, I remember when I was playing, I had to go work on the fish camps. And, you know, I think it's really interesting that they want to subsume my experience and use my face as this kind of thing. When it's like, when I walk through society, nobody looks at me and says, oh, this is an Indian. You know, I have nothing to do with that. That's not my experience, but they wanted me to do that. And I was literally just said, fuck you, I'm out of here. Like, you know, how dare you? So, you know, not only because it's disingenuous, because I shouldn't be the spokesperson for anyone. When you have people living in reservations, and my own cousins, my own relatives in villages, they're dying. They're literally dying, and I'm going to be the person you're going to represent. I mean, like, there's nepotism from high and low and many different levels here. And I just saw the whole thing as a bunch of bullshit. I shouldn't have even got in here in the first place. Yeah, I was like a decent artist, but I did graffiti. Like, you know, I had no understanding of this kind of like institutional art world. Like, I became an autodidact later in life after fucking up enough times, you know, not later in life, but you know, you get it. You know, I definitely wasn't 18 years old. So I kind of see the way in which that is a type of privilege, but it's also it's privilege on multiple levels, because it's privilege on the level of subjectivity. It's also privilege on the level of certain connections that you may have, you know? And so I just found the whole thing to be really disingenuous, which is why, you know, this, whatever you want to call it, late stage capitalism, if you care about your history and you care about your experience, why would you sell your experience out, you know, to perpetuate whatever this thing is? And I didn't want to be a part of it. I don't have nothing to do with it. So I'd rather be on the outside and say the unpopular thing and not play the game and keep those memories in my head alive, you know, because I don't want those to die. I want those to stay with me. So that's basically, you know, it. I don't know if that addressed anything, but that's, you know.
Yes, thank you very much. That's very helpful. And we're coming to the 2 hour. It's a little after 4, so maybe we should start wrapping it up. And if anyone has any summary statements, or something that you might have learned today, or direction you might want to go in, I'd be very curious. Thank you.
I'll just quickly say, since I don't know if the recording stops if I leave, but I'll be around until 4:30. So maybe that's when we can set, or 30 minutes from now, sorry, for anybody in California or where else. But I don't have anything to say. I like where this conversation is going.
Yes, I do need relative. You know, it's 4:30 for you guys. It's 9 o'clock at night here. I think it's interesting, Doug, that Jeffrey is here as the Cosmos host. So it'll probably switch over to you if he checks out.
But I need to go too. So
I know. So you got things, places to be, and things to do.
Yeah.
So I may or may not. But it's
I need to go too. So I need to go too. So just to let you know.
I just wanted to note that.
You guys are great. I just wanted to say that. Thanks for having me. I didn't mean to talk too much, but I got really excited. So
that's fine.
You guys are fantastic. Yeah, I love
it. It was good to listen to you, and good to meet you, Barrett. I didn't get a chance earlier to say hi.
Yeah, great. Thank you.
We like passionate people, so.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Oh, I can tell.
If I only had one last thing to say, it is, why is there no general outrage from the current neoliberal institutions regarding universal basic income?
That's a great question.
Why I would have expected more, but there's not. And I'm starting to think it's just a kind of a hunch, kind of an idea that I'm One of the things I learned in my, well, it wasn't just in the MBA that I did, but it was emphasized there. You always follow the money.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And if you do, if you just say, okay, let's follow the money, and they're quiet, then I think it says something. Because they're way too quiet.
I've seen a lot of outrage.
Not from corporate heads. Not from what we would call, let's say, the industrial, commercial, banking, blah, whatever elite.
Economic power elite.
Yeah, the economic power. Thank you, TV. Thank you. It's always nice to have somebody around that knows what I'm trying to say. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, the economic power elite.
No.
That was all.
I have to go.
Take care, Jeff.